Hi everyone, so good to be back in Paris. Very happy to be here with you. We're going to be together for roughly 20 minutes and try to give you some inputs about what we are doing in China. Quick question first, how many of you already purchased on Farfetch? Okay, so big potential of growth. That's good. That's why China is a very important market for us. So we are going to talk today about different elements. So one element we're going to share is from a creative to consumer centric, how the luxury brands are adapting themselves, how they are creating a new strategy. And of course, no matter you are in the lifestyle, in the watch jewelry, in the fashion industry, what kind of inputs you can have from this presentation. We're going to talk about different aspects. One is a quick introduction to give you some trends. You know, Farfetch is a 10-year-old company creating in 2008. We came up with this amazing concept of connecting boutique to one specific address. This was the tagline, I would say, 10 years ago, 400 boutiques, one address. And then we evolved step by step as a technological company to work with boutique directly, with brands directly. Today, we are working with more than 3,000 brands globally and nearly 1,000 boutiques. So as a technological company, we operate globally. Roughly 400 people worldwide, and of course when it goes to China, it's an extremely important market for us, and we're going to give you some input today. Starting directly with the trends. So we have specific trends when you go to customers. Some trends, of course, apply globally, some of the trends more in China, but this is some of the ones we can see together. The first one, obviously, the rise of social media. 5 years ago was probably one of the least influential media medium to influence a purchase. Today is the biggest one. When we go more into details, we have the demand for personalization and customization. For those who know the American markets, you have the DTC strategy, direct to consumer. This came to China, and yes, Chinese customers we do see are willing to pay more, waiting longer time to receive the product from the moment it's customized, from the moment it's personalized. So this is something very important. A third point about the demand of casual wear. You probably heard we acquired a company called Stadium Goods, which is a sneaker company, an amazing business, and now they are developing, of course, quite fast in China. So sneakers is extremely strong in terms of GMV, in terms of sales. And when it goes to the mix and matching, I want to wear a t-shirt from a mass market brand with a pair of Balenciaga Triple S. I want to mix and match different brands from different elements. This is a trend we do see. And finally, of course, the demand for collaboration. This is not something only specific to the Chinese markets, but also globally. Brand A partner with brand B, and both of them try to influence their user base to define, to create a new product. So these trends, I think you can take it regarding the Chinese consumer, regarding the global Chinese customer, and it's something we can leverage and that we're working on every day. Some data for you in terms of profile. So the advantage to work with a global platform is we do have data, we do have information globally. No matter from the US customer, from the Chinese customer, from the Hong Kongese customer, if you want to be more specific. Right now, we are showing you more insights about the Chinese customer. Chinese customer for us is the youngest we have globally, all markets included. Average speaking, 30, 31 years old. This is the average age of a China mainland customer. If you talk about globally, if you talk about, for example, Hong Kong markets, 36 years old, 37 years old. So in China, they are the youngest we have worldwide. In terms of gender splits, 61% female, 39% male. The male category is something, of course, growing quite fast in China. If you go into the spending capability, so this is a very interesting aspect. Our customers, so people shopping on Farfetch, when we do a survey, when we ask them about their purchasing capability or purchasing behavior, they claim to spend roughly 15,000 US in fashion every year. Not only on Farfetch, just in general. In fashion every year. So this is extremely high. If you compare these numbers from a French perspective or British perspective or an Italian perspective, this is much more high, this is higher in China. One interesting point is we all know that when it goes to retail, when it goes to luxury, to be more specific, 90% of the sales happen offline. However, when you talk to people who are sophisticated and buy often online, like the fashion customers, they claim that 64% of the fashion they are buying. They are buying it online. So to recap, customers extremely young, very sophisticated, very advanced when it goes to consume online, and of course, high spending capabilities. How can we communicate with them? What kind of media we need to use? Of course, social media will be the key one. WeChat, no surprise, will be the main platform they're going to use. Follow quickly by Weibo. Instagram, yes, there is an impact when you communicate on Instagram. I think there is recently an Italian brand who communicated on Instagram. The feedback was wrongly received, I would say, in China. You have about 100 million plus of VPN in China. Even if the government is cracking VPN down, still, a sophisticated customer with significant purchasing capability, most of the time, he or she might see you, might follow you on Instagram. So no matter what you do here, there's an impact in China. So that's some trends, some customer profile we can share with you today. Going more into the positioning of the brands, how they position themselves facing this changing audience. These are, of course, different aspects. The first one, in terms of trends, we have the online to offline activities. We're going to show you some case studies, following by mini-program activation. So you know, mini-program is related to the WeChat ecosystem. Personalization and exclusivity, we talked about this morning in one of the sessions. We're going to mention it today. And conversion by social commerce. Finally, we finish with a case study for you to see how an international brand in luxury business, in fashion business, communicates in the West, but how they adapt themselves in China with a specific activation. The first one is activation from online to offline. So how many of you have been to the Louis Vuitton exhibition at Le Grand Palais? Okay, did any of you saw the one in Shanghai recently? Okay, which one do you prefer? You saw only that one? Okay, okay. The main difference, well, besides the decor of the Grand Palais, even as a French, I would say it was extremely nice, in Shanghai, the technology, the way they're going to communicate with you, will be via a mini-program. And so make your experience extremely smooth. You buy the ticket on the mini-program, you can visit the exhibition of the mini-program, you can share with your friends. So that's an example of translation. From the West, we're going to probably use an app. In China, we're going to use a mini-program. Moving on with the mini-program topic itself is a whole strategy. So depend, of course, the level of development of your brands. But if you are international brands, you cannot have only a WeChat strategy, you need to have a proper mini program strategy. This is very important. Don't see it as a transactional tool only. It's an amazing recruitment tool. In a nutshell, it's an app that you don't need to download. Meaning that if a brand opens a mini program today, the increase of following base we have will be significant compared to opening a WeChat account today. Both work in parallel, but don't be stuck on the fact to see a mini program as transactional only. It's an amazing branding, communication, and recruitment tool. Moving on with the idea of personalization, we saw it this morning. I don't go too much into details. An example for Sergio Rossi, how they can customize a soulier, a pair of shoes, and you're going to select the size of the heel, the color, the patches you can put on the shoes, and of course, spend a little bit more money, wait a little bit more time, but you have something very unique. This is something you can work on. And to finish with last trend, which is social commerce and the idea of moving from a pure communication to social media. Jio, when they create in Chengdu an activation with KOL, they invite KOL to sit in Chengdu, they do a live streaming, and then you can purchase directly from it. This is just an example. Of course, the price points, 400, 500 RMB, will be lower than the fashion luxury products, but this is a trend that we do see and that you can keep in mind. The case study I want to share with you today is a fashion brand, Moncler, who decides in China to have a specific activation when it goes to content, when it goes to video production. The product I want to push is a sneaker called Bubble. I want to put a sneaker, but in China, I know the customer are different. I know maybe the assets I have globally might not be relevant. How can I create locally to have something that gives echo that I would say push people to explore and obviously to convert? The concept here is quite simple. You have a sneaker. You create, actually, with the platform you heard about, TikTok, Douyin, and we did a partnership with them to push this specific product. The concept was dancing. TikTok is a platform about dancing. We create something similar. So that's more on the content side of things. We select different key opinion leaders who, in a nutshell, they are the guys who won a China Got Talent for the dance show, for the dance activity. So this guy, for example, is very famous to do the locking. I don't know if any of you are dancers in the room, but from what I know, you block yourself when you dance. So that's the locking. If your son or daughter do some popping, you can ask him to explain what is popping. And of course, we have the breakdance. Breakdancing, we all know about it. So let's see how it can look like in practice. We do have photo shooting that the brand can use, but when it goes to video production, we're going to have teaser, and then we're going to have full-time video. This content is created in China mainland with Chinese KOL facing Chinese platforms, TikTok, WeChat, Weibo, KOL accounts, and then last facing the Chinese audience. And when you see the three full-time video, you're going to have a little bit different style, breakdancing, locking, and popping, all that very simple. Driven, and the way to shoot the content, you are not going to shoot the product itself only, the sneaker. You try to make it bigger picture. Bigger picture because then the brand can use the assets for the whole collection. So that's an example of the content we're going to do for our partner in China to shoot, to produce locally, and how we can do that because in terms of development, we have different divisions. And it looks silly to say that from a marketplace or e-commerce platform, but we do have content capability and digital marketing creation capability. When we are moving to luxury brands and their strategy, of course, the market is changing every 3 months, every 6 months. So what we said today in March in Paris might not be relevant next September. So today in March, what kind of things we can share with you regarding the strategy? The first one is when to have a focus, when you need to pay attention to what's going on in terms of calendar. In terms of calendar, you need obviously to have the Western festivals versus the Chinese one. And when it goes to do something, whatever you do it or not is your call from a marketer perspective, but you know when things are happening. So in orange, this is the Chinese festival, and in blue, this is the Western festival. For everyone to be aware, the Chinese calendar is based on the moon, so it's changing every year. That's why last year was different, and next year will be again different. So maybe we don't need to do anything related to the Buddha birthday, pretty hard to market. But if you want to do something for Children's Day, doing kids' wear, maybe it's a good opportunity for me to push my brand during the Children's Day. So that's the calendar, is when to focus. When it goes to what kind of platform consider, this is more the digital marketing strategy. Obviously, WeChat and Mini Program are still leading the race, but you have beautiful platform, Little Red Book, TikTok doing that, you need to consider. This was quite new, so 2018 was really the race of those two platforms. Then, two or 3 years ago, was mostly WeChat Weibo. Now you have new paths happening, new platforms happening that you can consider. This is a slide that I like very much. It's what you are facing from a brand perspective in China. This is what you face, which is a very fragmented offer. When you go to China, you want to go, let's say, strong. You see a lot of different partners you need to deal with. You need to work with an e-commerce partner, an e-commerce operator, we call it also TP, for Tmall partner, it's a generic term. We need to work with third-party platforms. We need to work with a media company, a CRM company, or a creative agency. What we try to do for our partners, no matter it's brands, boutique, agencies, we really try to rationalize everything. Content, social media, and CRM, that's one aspect. And then when it goes to e-commerce and media and advertising. When a brand works with Farfetch in China, from a personal perspective, they don't ask you to just put the product on the shelf and pray for someone to click on it. They come to you and say, look, I need a strategy. I need a content input. I need data about your customers, how to position my brand. How can you help? And that's why in terms of strategy facing the brands, we try to be very, very broad. And we offer different segmentation, different department expertise for the marketers, or the e-commerce expert, or the CRM experts to crack the Chinese market. I will share with you, and that will be the last part of the presentation. If you have any questions, feel free to raise your hands. This is a recent case study we did in China facing the luxury Chinese customer. Balenciaga is going to do a global launch campaign with Farfetch. And of course, when it goes to China activation, China is a different animal, we need something different. So this case study is for you to see the different touch points you might have in mind when it goes to activate something in China, when it goes to not only convert, but before converting someone to something, you need to communicate. You need to have the right content. You need to have the right media exposure. So on this, we have different touch points. The first one is obviously have a relevant content facing the Chinese market. We're going to work with Phil, which is a very famous key opinion leader, and we're going to co-create specific content facing that specific Balenciaga collection to the end user, to the Chinese millennial, to the Chinese Farfetch customer. From there, media and advertising. They're going to occupy the whole marketplace for them to have visibility, targeting the people you saw earlier during the presentation. Very young, very sophisticated, high-spending capabilities. We're going to help also our partners with organic content and with specific China APP. In China, one of the specificities we do have is to have a whole tech engineering team creating, innovating, thinking for the market. And so we have our own China app, which is a very significant driver in terms of sales. And we have, of course, a WeChat strategy, a Weibo strategy, a mini program strategy that we use to help our partners to promote their products. Moving on, mini program, we mentioned it before. Again, the brand is going to occupy the whole Farfetch mini program. Because they need help, we're going to create a mini program dedicated for them, link directly to our inventory for the conversion. We're going to have advertising. We saw it a little bit earlier. You promote a WeChat account. You promote a mini program. And to finish, PR clippings to give them exposure in the market, negotiating with celebrities, engaging celebrities, and obviously at the end, have an offline integration based on CRM. Private client team at Farfetch, which is the guys dealing with VIPs, are going to connect with the Farfetch customer interested in Balenciaga products or related brands. And we're going to invite them to a specific activation. This one was in Shanghai. For those who know Shanghai, it's the Puli Hotel. So it's a nice hotel in Shanghai. You privatize the whole penthouse, the two biggest suites, one for the men, one for the ladies, and then you welcome all your VIPs. You welcome the Farfetch VIPs to the top. All the stylists are there, and then the VIP have an experience. An experience that I would say money cannot buy. They can discover the new collection. They can try the new collection. They have especially special advices of the team. And of course, we have models that we hire. The models, they're in the middle. The customer, they're on the left. So don't mix up. The red hair is a customer. So we invite these beautiful ladies and men to come, not only because they shop on Farfetch, but because they're extremely influential. And that's the things we wanted to share with you today in terms of positioning. The evolution of China makes it extremely challenging to be very siloed. So if you work with someone, you need to be very broad. You are a marketplace, you are a platform, so you do have data. Do you need to only do e-commerce? No, you need to enlarge. We call it the premium luxury gateway solution, which is a solution for any brands willing to enter the market to have not only an e-commerce strategy, but also a digital marketing, content, CRM, or media exposure. So that's, in a nutshell, the things we wanted to share with you today. Hope you find it interesting. And if you have any question, I'm here for that. Thank you very much.